If it escaped your notice that the Antiques Roadshow is celebrating its 30th anniversary, then you really haven't been watching. We've talked a lot about the years between now and then. We turn the speedometer back to 1977, the year the show actually began. In those days, to eager young petrol heads, the TR6 was the coolest set of wheels on the block, and fashion was extremely groovy. Yesterday's gone, yesterday's gone. It was a time when women walked tall in stacked wedges. Cutting-edge flares were a menace to small children and dogs. Shirt collars were capable of lift-off. And a velvet jacket wasn't just worn in private, it was in vogue. Just suppose we kept all that groovy gear in mothballs and the flash motor in mint condition. Well, back in the days when the Roadshow was sucking on its dummy, my TR6 was worth just over £1,300. Now it's worth £13,000, a good investment. And that's what today's Roadshow is all about, making a smart investment for the future, my son. And we found the ideal backdrop. Get an eyeful of the Delaware Pavilion, Bexhill-on-Sea. In its day, it was seen by some as brash and ahead of its time, just too modern for its own good. 70 years on, it's a design icon. Which leads us to ask, what objects from our recent past should we cherish for the future? Eric Knowles is already in the groove.
Looking at a gramophone such as this, this is the ultimate desire. This and an MGBGT was all I ever wanted back in the 1960s. This particular radio gramophone, to give its proper title, I think, obviously was first introduced in 1956.
That's right.
Am I right?
Yes, you are.
Good. It is, without question, a piece of classic design. I mean, people use this term, icons of design, and this is, because it's revolutionary for its age. Back in 1956, nobody had ever seen anything quite like it. And what made it special was the fact that it had got this Perspex cover. I mean, this is space age in every shape or form. So just, I want to know how long you've been playing with it.
Well, I bought it in 65. There was a shop in London called Imhoff's. It was opposite then the new Centre Point.
Oh, yes.
And we bought it from there because we saw it and we loved with it. The very same thing, we thought it was such a marvellous design. And it was just something you wanted to cuddle almost. It seems silly, but it's so lovely. And then we've had it since then. It's been in a loft for 30 years now.
Oh, what a shame.
It is, yes. But if now this was 100 watts a channel and stereo, I'd take all my hi-fi out and put this back because I like it so much.
But it's the bee's knees, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
What's always made it endearing to me is the fact that it's always been referred to as Snow White's coffin. For obvious reasons, hasn't it? But shall we just have a quick look inside? It's Spartan, isn't it?
It is.
There's no waste of space here. First of all, let's extol the virtues of the maker, Braun. I mean, Braun led the way here and everybody else followed. What I find interesting on your turntable you've got 16 revolutions, 33 and 45. Well, 45 ruled the 60s, it ruled the 70s. 16, what do you use 16 for?
The main is speech, LPs, right. Plays and things like that. Very few produced, but it was there.
OK. Yeah. Now, the big question is, what did you pay for it?
I think it was 79 guineas with the speaker.
A lot of money in 1965.
We couldn't afford the stereo version. That's,
no, that's that was a month's wages and more.
Yes.
OK, well, today, its value is nearer £300. Oh. I've got to say that around about 10 years ago, they were making around about 400, 500. It depends very much on the actual model. This is an SK...
55.
And I think value does depend on the actual model itself.
Exactly, yeah.
So if we were saying 300 today, what are we going to say in 30 years' time? This is the bit where I wish I was working alongside Mystic Meg. But I dare say that you'll be looking probably nearer £1,000 in 30 years. I'll tell you what. Let's make an arrangement now. We will meet here at the Delaware Pavilion in 30 years' time, and we'll see how wrong or how right I might be.
I'd love to do that. I don't think we will, but I'd love to.
I'm forever the optimist.
When I see that Bieber logo, it sort of brings back the whole of my teenage years. And opening up the catalogue, there we see one of those terribly evocative photographs. But also, what's even better, of course, you've got the real thing. Now, who is the Bieber nut? Sorry, I mean, this is a colloquial term. We're amongst friends.
Well, probably both of us. So my sister was the one who introduced me to it because she used to go up to London. And
so you were the older sister?
Yes,
okay,
I, absolutely. We shared a bedroom.
So say no more. For any girl of our age, you know, it was the destination. Yes. Saturday morning, off you'd go.
It certainly was, yes.
Tell me your reminiscences, actually, of the shop itself. Well, describe it to me.
Well, my reminiscences were first of the Kensington Church Street branch, where it was so atmospheric. I mean, I was into Art Nouveau, and it's all very much in tune with that.
Exactly. They ended up, of course, in Derry and Toms in Kensington High Street, which was this shrine,
it really was,
to girly consumerism, was that it was a real destination. I mean, they had cafe, they had homewares, they had a whole floor devoted to the sort of Casbah scene with Moroccan and Turkish artifacts and so on. And, of course, makeup. This is what, a Bicky tin or a cake tin?
I just loved it because it was that sort of 1930s style that I loved. And to the colours, I think the colours together, you know, the gold and the black and the red are just perfect.
And terribly brave at that stage.
Yes.
I mean, we are looking at it with the benefit of hindsight, when we all know about Art Deco and about the colour schemes that were used. But actually in the 60s, this was really cutting edge, really new.
It was, because I think in the 60s everything was very modern, and it was going back to that sort of, you know, eras that... you know, very much in the past, and were being swept away, really.
Exactly. Yeah. This was the era when everybody was burning their Victorian furniture on bonfires, you know. And Barbara Hulanicki, who started Bieber in 1964, went right against the trends because she was using these dusty pinks, these plums, dark browns, greys, and I think she described it as auntie colours.
Yes.
You know, the sort of things perhaps your maiden aunt would be wearing. I mean, the coat is fabulous, and that's what I call traditional Bieber style, what they set out to do.
Yes.
And this is obviously, you know,
psychedelic, because I was kind of into that at the time, and this was the closest they did to the wilder patterns.
Exactly.
That's why I went for it, really.
Exactly. Now, we've got lots of memorabilia here. I want to know, how sad is it?
Yes.
How sad is it that somebody here keeps a bag with the receipt?
I didn't even know the receipt was still on it until I fetched that out. I couldn't
believe you for a moment.
Well,
it's 26th of June, 1974.
And you know, I can look that up in my diary, and because I used to, every time I went to London, I had to go to Bieber's. I
mean, it was a
pilgrimage, and I had to buy something. So, and I just kept them because they were too lovely to throw away.
Absolutely.
I mean, as far as value is concerned, prices vary. You know, from perhaps £30 or so, £40 perhaps for a catalogue, up to 100, 150, maybe £200 for a simple piece of clothing,
nice.
To something perhaps a little bit more for the coat that you've got on. But how much was the biscuit tin originally? Well, there we go. Originally 40p. Today, I would have thought £15.
Really?
I think if you ever decide that you want to add to the collection, you will find plenty of venues out there which will enable you to feed your habit.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Well, it's a sunny but windy day here in Bexhill, so I'm very glad you've brought your heater. Perhaps we can turn it on.
And it works.
It works, even better. But why have you brought your heater?
Because it was a wedding present to us when we were married in 1961.
Right.
Having met up there in the ballroom and in the dance floor.
You met in this building?
Yes.
In 1959, yes. Across a crowded room, our eyes met.
And it's been wonderful ever since.
Wonderful ever since, yes. Wonderful ever since, hasn't it?
So, this heater comes into your life when you get married in, what was it, 1961?
Yes.
And were you modernists?
Well, we actually had no furniture at all, really, apart from bits like this. So I think we were modernists. I was. I'm not sure that Richard
was,
but I was.
Minimalist, but you couldn't afford anything else.
So minimalism is actually to do with having no money?
Yes.
When you're first married?
Yeah.
New
yeah.
definition of minimalism. Yeah. This is obviously an iconic object of that period. This is very much the contemporary look, spiky legs and all that sort of thing. It has that sort of space age feel about it. And this is a very collectible object. They're not rare. They fetch anything from £50 to £150, depending on condition and colour. There are different colourways. And it's just nice that you have it, you still use it, and it links so precisely to the building. It is the style that was outrageous in the 1930s. By the 1950s and 60s, it had become, in a sense, accepted. But the great thing is, you know, this is a record of coming together here.
Yeah.
Actually, it does go very well with the building, doesn't it? When you see it here,
it's in perfect setting.
Love them or loathe them, West German ceramics of the 1960s and 70s are really becoming quite a collectible area, aren't they?
Yes.
I mean, they shout so much of the period, these incredible bright oranges here and these amazing reds and lava glazes. They certainly evoke emotions and reactions in people when they see them. Are you married? Do you have a partner, a family?
Yes, I have a partner, and she loves them as much as I do.
She loves them as much as you do?
I think so, yeah.
Two people in the same house that love them?
Yep.
I'm amazed. I mean, most of the time you either come across... It sort of divides people, I suppose. You come across people who love them or completely hate them.
Yeah.
They're a very sort of emotive subject. And they've really grown in value and interest over the past few years. I mean, how long have you been collecting?
Only since last year.
How many do you have now?
In total, over 400.
400? Where do you keep them all?
Scattered around the house everywhere. In every room there's some somewhere. These are the smaller ones of the collection.
So now, where do you find these pieces? Do you travel all over the country? Do you go to Germany, the home of West German pottery? Or
I have been to Germany, but not had much success there. But most of it's come from car boot sales and various places around the country and online trading.
Do you have a favourite piece?
The Roth is one of the favourites.
I mean, this piece is absolutely fantastic. It, again, just shouts of the sort of space age.
Yeah.
And it's also got, which to me, I'd be interested to hear what you think of that. It's got, to me, one of the most interesting features. It's these lava glazes.
Yeah.
I mean, West German ceramics of this period are sort of known by collectors as fat lava.
Yes,
bad translation from the German, I think, is where it originated from.
Yes.
It's an appealing name, I suppose, but it does somehow describe these perfectly well, these bright sort of volcanic oranges and volcanic bubbling glazes.
Yeah.
Very, very little is known about them. People are finding a bit more out. I mean, I've been looking into this market for a couple of years now. I mean, this piece, I'm sure you know, is by a company called Scheurich.
Yeah.
And you can tell that from the shape and from the glaze, but also from the marks, isn't that right?
That's right, yes.
Yeah, this particular type of mark was used by Scheurich only. So there's a certain way of looking at all those factors together to identify who made that piece. Looking at value, this is, of course, our 30th year of the Antiques Roadshow. Mm-hmm. And we're looking at sort of what things might be worth 30 years from now.
Yeah.
And I think this is a fantastically hot area. I can only see growth in this area. I mean, I think you're very, very wise to invest now and to start building up a collection of good pieces, especially pieces as good as this and this one here. Okay. There are so many makers, people are beginning to collect them and beginning to research them properly. What did you pay for this? Tell me.
I think it was more than £5 or £10, that's all.
That's the great joy of these at the moment. They're amazingly affordable, and you can find them in car boot sales, junk fairs, design shops. I mean, £5 or £10 today, you paid, I would have thought that in 30 years' time you're going to be looking at sort of 70, 80 pounds, maybe 100. And in fact, something like this, the Roth piece, which I just think is so superb, I mean, that's already worth 70 to 100 pounds. What did you pay for that one?
I think about £20.
£20. I mean, it's £20 well spent. Yeah. I can see that really being £200 to £300 in 30 years' time, if not more.
That's
so if you multiply that by your whole collection, you're really looking quite a large sum.
I am. Thank you.
This just grabs me good and proper. So what grabbed you about it?
Well, it was just the glass, the steel and the wood. I was just struck by it. And I thought how attractive it looked. And I bought it in a shop in Hythe in Kent. A chap sells lots of Scandinavian pottery and glass, and I just liked it.
Well, what we have here is a piece that utterly reflects a movement towards art, glass as art, as a sculpture. I mean, this is not a vessel. You know, it's not a tumbler, it's not a wine glass. It is what it is. What you see is what you get.
Yes.
It's designed by a sculptor, amazingly, called Bertil Valin for Costa in the early 70s. And I would suggest that this piece will really stand the test of time. So you paid?
£200.
£200. Well, I think that at auction now we're four to five. So you were selling it. So how long ago did you buy it?
About 7 or 8 years, I
So it's doubled in 10 years, and I reckon in 30 years we're up to 10 times. So I reckon that's a £2,000 piece in 30 years.
Oh, that's fantastic news.
And if you don't want it, I can give it a good home.
I'm sure you could. Thank you very much.
Great.
One is so used to seeing this image on T-shirts and on teenage bedroom walls, it's extraordinary to think that we could well be dealing with the 1970s original and these others as well. Tell me I'm right.
You are. We were on holiday 3 years ago in Havana, and we toured all the way through Havana down to Santiago de Cuba. And on the way through, I was on the hunt specifically for Cuban political artwork and posters and political art. And these turned up, but I had to go a long way through to find them.
So these are highly charged bits of political propaganda produced during, you know, the Fidel Castro regime that's out there at the moment. And this one in particular, celebrating Che Guevara, his great pin-up, and indeed the great revolutionary pin-up. So how on earth did you get your hands on them?
I got them from a printing studio, which was very fortunate, after a lot of bartering and haggling, and then managed to get them out of the country with some difficulty.
Well, look, tell me about the bartering and haggling, because it's quite difficult negotiating
These were not for sale, so after 3 days of going into this certain place, I kept saying, will you sell, will you sell? No, senor, we no sell. And I said, please, and I said, they're beautiful, will you let them go? They eventually, after 3 days, said, you're serious, and then opened this cupboard, and there they were. And I was just astounded.
And did you use money to buy them?
I bartered and used cash, and I was just very lucky.
What did you barter?
I bartered cigarettes.
Right.
Because they don't smoke a very good quality of cigarette over there. I just managed to gave
them away. Shrewd one. Yep. Okay, now how did you get them out? Having got them?
I bought original artworks as well from galleries, which you have to have receipts for to get out, so I rolled them inside the artwork that I'd got from the galleries.
Sounds a bit shady.
It was very tricky, and then shrunk wrap all my luggage, and then got called at the customs area.
Oh, right.
And then they asked to search through my luggage. During that, there was a chap behind me that had 4,000 cigars, so I think they looked upon me as saying, well, he can go, they grabbed the chap with the cigars.
Oh,
nice. I felt blessed when I walked out of the door. I went,
I bet you.
And just walked on down the road, and it made our holiday.
Now, is this a big collection you've got?
Yeah, I've got over a dozen to 14. I think about 14 of these.
And you both live with these at home, do you?
We do.
Yeah. What's it like living with revolutionary icons at home?
Brilliant. They're just such brilliant images. And they go well with the other work we've got, contemporary British prints.
But I think you're dealing with something extremely rare and emotive here. I mean, for a start, there aren't any others on the market. you risked life and limb and a lot of cigarettes to get these things. They are themselves phenomenally powerful, potent. They're almost like religious artifacts in that way. I mean, they carry a message. They didn't want you to have them either.
No, they didn't.
Well, it's rather sort of heightens the excitement. This image here of Che Guevara is as potent and powerful as Holbein's portrait of Henry VIII. I mean, it's just one of those great images of history. And to actually have a 70s poster, you know, roughly about the time that this was being massively disseminated.
Fortunate thing.
Quite. What about value, though? And what about value now, and what about value in the future? Give me some idea of the cost of these things.
I think I spent in between the region of... you don't see the whole series here, but I spent between £2,000 and £3,000
really?
On the whole series.
So serious money. Well, value now, I think there must be people out there who would give you a very substantial profit on what you paid. I think these things could well be worth low thousands now each. But let's look at the future and compare it to what's going on with Russian art at the moment. I mean, now, post-Glasnost, Russian art, your Lenins and your Stalins and what have you, sometimes painted rather well, are getting highly collected.
Yeah.
So I'm going to speculate that these items that you have in 30 years' time could be worth then the equivalent of £20,000 a piece. I think there's no doubt about it, you've got your hands on something extraordinarily scarce. So good luck,
thanks
for telling me the story.
Okay, it's a pleasure.
If you can, cast your mind back to 1977. If you can't, ask you that. As I recall, it was the Queen's Silver Jubilee, Virginia Wade won Wimbledon, and Star Wars was on its way to becoming one of the top films of all time. But apart from the birth of the Antiques Roadshow, what was telly up to in 1977?
And time to come alive with some hit music and jive on this week's Top of the Pops!
Can do multiplication sums on your fingers.
This may look like an ordinary piece of corrugated iron.
Is France.
From the BBC.
I loved him, loved his music.
Are you lonesome tonight? Do you miss me?
Elvis Presley will still be the king of rock and roll to me. He really and truly will.
We drifted apart.
Hello and welcome to Ask Casper.
£5,050.
Okay, girls, let's get to the bottom of this. Tell me how you got started, because we are surrounded by... Well, it's sort of Starsky and Hutch heaven, really, isn't it?
It is for us.
What was the first thing you bought?
That would be the Starsky doll. And notice the cardigan.
I am noticing the cardigan.
Which was knitted by my mother in 1975.
It's sheer
devotion, sheer devotion.
And did she knit you that one at the same time?
No, my friend here knitted this one.
And who made the jacket?
Made the Hutch jacket, yes. Matches the Hutch doll.
let's work. So you became, this is not your life.
You have normal lives. Yes, we do have lives.
But you share this extraordinary passion for Starsky and Hutch.
We do. Yes.
So there you were, glued to the TV sets. Wednesday that it went out?
Saturday.
Yeah. Prime time.
That was repeats on the Wednesdays.
And they were a complete phenomenon, really, from day one, weren't they?
Yes, they were.
And I mean, to put it into context, there weren't any similar hard-hitting detective series at that time. And I mean, at one point, I think that the censors were getting really worried about Starsky and Hutch because it was too violent.
It was.
We think of it as kind of... things made for kids, but it wasn't, was it?
It was well ahead of its time.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Serious issues. Yes. Prostitution, drug addiction. Yeah. And yet, the nub of the show, the friendship between the two men, is what made it so long-lasting.
And they were good-looking. I know that's a minor point, but...
Not for me, it wasn't. I have to say, he was my favourite.
Oh, yes.
It's about 50-50.
Yes.
So now tell me, you said that you bought this at the time. Were you both buying at the time?
I was. I was buying quite avidly. My poor mum. She spent so much money. But we bought the magazines, which were monthly, the bubblegum cards.
Bubblegum cards,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
So you were collecting from the start. And what were you also?
Now I'm a bit older, so it wasn't quite right for a mature woman. 22, I think, to collect at that time. But I did go and buy the magazines because
right.
those were so special. And every month, more pictures, yep. more letters, more stories.
And I can see he touched this page.
He did. Yes.
Signed, yes.
Since, I mean, there are some things here that one sees relatively regularly. I mean, the corgi toy is something that you see, and some of these games turn up. Mm. I must say that there are some things that are rarer. This, for instance, I don't remember seeing.
Yes.
I mean, when one's talking about valuing a collection like this, I guess value is kind of not what it's about.
It's priceless to us.
It's priceless, yes.
But I mean, the price for instance, that corgi,
this one,
the Torino there, yes. with the sort of spread eagle guy.
Yes.
I mean, that varies between about £100 and £250
right.
on the internet,
mm-hmm.
depending on which day you're
uh-huh.
looking.
Yes.
And I mean, the great thing is, because there is an international fan base, that a collection like this is going to go up in value. More and more people are going to become fans.
This was a time of innocence and not having to worry about your mortgage or your children or anything mm. else. All you had to worry about was whether your mum was going to give you enough money to buy your Starsky & Hutch magazine.
Who can ask more from a collection than to do that?
Yes.
Than to take you back
mm-hmm.
to a time when you were happy and carefree and were just mm-hmm. looking forward to the next programme.
Absolutely,
real escapism.
Yes.
I don't suppose either of you can remember the theme tune.
Let me see.
Do you
want
to go?
I feel very comfortable sitting here. I feel I could spend a long time chatting around this table. Is this something you use a lot?
We have used it a lot in the past. Particularly sort of family dinners and things like that.
This, I think, is interesting because we've got a whole ensemble here, sideboard, chairs, table, and it's becoming extremely fashionable. It's retro furniture, but you said you've had it for quite a long time, so when did you get it?
In the late 1950s, leading up to 1960, when we got married. We were working in London at the time, and places like the Design Centre in the Haymarket, Liberty's, they were all the sort of places we tended to visit, and the sort of teak and stainless steel look was coming in at that time. We decided we wanted it and ordered it at a local store in Maidstone.
Excellent.
And they got it for us.
Fantastic. So you were very design conscious when you
yes.
were when you were young?
Yes.
And did you know when you bought this set that it was designed in 1959?
I don't think we knew that at the time, but I'm a retired architect now, and at the time people like John and Sylvia Reed, who were the designers, we were aware of that
yes.
sort of thing that was going on.
Yeah. But I think it's worth looking at what really makes it so interesting as a design. You've got this lovely oval table, and it extends.
It
so
does,
sort of,
yes.
So how many leaves does it have?
It's got a centre leaf, which is stored underneath.
So it makes a very, very elegant elliptical
yes.
shape,
yes.
which
yes.
is very much of its period, isn't it? This sort of modern, simple, streamlined shape.
Yeah.
And then the chairs are very simple, metal legs, as is the table, and this sort of slightly geometrical, elliptical shape for the back.
Yes.
And it's interesting, I think, picking up the metal legs, that really is a pre-Second World War feature that came in through Bauhaus and so on.
Mm.
But also this kind of back, really is looking to Danish or Scandinavian design,
yes,
as well, isn't it?
Yes.
So that you're really combining the two elements of German modernism and Scandinavian humanism, if you like, in the shape. So let's move over here and see what we got behind you, because also getting a whole ensemble in terms of design was something relatively new for can I say ordinary people, rather than kind of aristocratic design, yes, commissions of the 18th and 19th century. A little stool here, the chairs have been, I think, reupholstered at some point, and this is the original fabric.
Right. Yes.
There is the manufacturer's label, Stag. And you mentioned John and Sylvia Reed, and they were the modern designers for Stag, I think, weren't they? But what's also interesting is to look at the kind of construction, because it's not the very highest engineering quality. It's quite simple, isn't it? This was the accessible face of
Absolutely.
The new design,
yeah.
I think. Yeah. And the sideboard here, too. Stylish little pulls here. I like that, with cutlery drawer inside. Can you remember what you paid for it?
No, we've been trying to think of that. It's almost impossible to think back to those times. It was probably sort of £30 or £40 type of money, which was a lot.
It was quite a lot, yes, absolutely.
You know, when we were not earning that much.
For a while, this kind of thing, as I'm sure you know, was completely out of fashion. Nobody wanted it really at all. And now it's becoming much, much more fashionable. But it's still up and down. If you look on internet sites, you can probably find a set of chairs for, I don't know, £100. Elsewhere, I've seen a set of dining set just like this one, in nice condition as this is, going for, at auction, this is about £850. And the sideboard, you might be lucky and buy one for around £200, or you might have to spend at auction £600. So it's still one of those markets which is very, very fluid, but I think it's going to become much more fashionable in the future as people begin to see how comfortable it is to live with, how simple the designs are, how elegant the designs are.
I don't know whether the children will want it, but
it's theirs. Convince them that this is the new Chippendale, and you'll be away.
So we've got 30 years of the Antiques Roadshow and 30 years of the Star Wars saga, of course, this being the sixth film. You were presumably a fan as a child.
Yeah, it just blew me away. He's never seen anything like it before, really.
So this, of course, being an actually quite important poster. Do you know why this is such an interesting poster?
Because they changed the name at the last minute from Revenge to Return.
That's it. I think they felt, the story is that George Lucas felt that revenge wasn't something that a Jedi should really have.
Right.
So a little bit un-Jedi-like, so they changed it. The other interesting thing about this poster is that it's probably one of the most faked movie posters.
Yeah.
And there are three pointers that I tend to look at. I mean, one of the very recent reproductions was actually effectively taken from one of the folded posters. So you have to look very closely at the fold marks to make sure that through the actual fold there aren't other marks within the poster, because that will indicate it's a reproduction. Of course, the other side of it is the fact that the Star Wars running along here is quite often in orange and not this yellow. Sometimes there's a little red line at the top.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah. And then the Fox logo is normally slightly blurry on some of the reproduction posters.
The one in the corner, yeah?
The one in the bottom corner, right. That's right, yes. And sometimes it's a much darker blue as well. So we haven't got the fold lines. We've got a solid black, we've got a nice light blue, and we've got a yellow here across for the Star Wars. My feeling is that it's based on that, and that they're the normal hallmarks of it being a reproduction or a fake. I think this is brilliant. I think this is absolutely correct.
But why? It's good.
But it's
very
also
good.
Very good news from the financial side of it as well, because I don't know what you paid for it.
I paid around, just short of $100.
Well, if it was a fake, I think you'd have been looking at around sort of £10. I mean, it's purely decorative value, really. As little as that. But an authentic one like this, I can see fetching anything from sort of £250, £300, maybe a little more. It's a sort of notorious poster. It's an iconic poster. Darth Vader, of course, you know, featuring large is a good thing. And one little last feature, I don't know whether you've ever noticed this. Have you ever looked at the lightsabers?
They're the wrong way round.
They are the wrong way round, exactly. It's just another interesting feature. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Now, I was around in the 1970s, and I think I was reasonably up-to-date, you know, fairly pacey. I never had an LED watch. I don't know why, it just never sort of grabbed me. But obviously it's grabbed you.
When I was a kid in the late 70s, my dad bought me a cheap LED watch that I used to overnight lander the bed sheets, pressing the button until it wore out, looking at the red LED glowing. But then I realised that, you know, with these watches, they are quite collectible, the early models. So
when did you start again?
Well, it was about 10 years ago. I bought a fashion magazine. I was flicking through the article and there was a picture of an Omega LED watch, and I thought, I remember when I was a kid owning one of them watches, so I thought, it seems like a good thing to collect. So kind of started to go back as a kid and collecting them.
So you were going back to your childhood?
Yeah, I mean, just reminiscing, basically.
And so where does it start? Have you got it here?
Well, it starts there with the...
The
Pulsar P1, that came out in early 72.
So everybody saw that and thought, God, we better make those.
Yeah.
So Omega do it,
yep.
Everybody else does it.
Yeah, soon after, the Omega was the first European LED watch.
Right.
But Pulsar was the first. I mean, that was very expensive back in the early 70s to buy.
So what would that cost then?
$2,100 in
God,
19...
So that's nearly £1,000.
Yeah, in 72 you would have...
Which is a huge amount of money.
Yeah.
Now, when does it die out?
Around about 77, Pulsar closed because the LCD market took over.
Hang on, let's get this right. LED, LCD.
Yeah, light-emitting diode,
yes.
LED, LCD liquid crystal display. And the battery life was a lot longer,
yeah.
Whereas the LEDs...
So this is a short period in watch history?
Yeah, 6 years, and it was pretty much done with, you know.
And that, then it's all over?
Then it was all over.
I mean, I must say, when I look at them now, I missed it at the time, like I missed quite a lot in the 70s,
yeah.
I think. But I can see now what it is, you know.
Yeah.
It has a very, very strong statement about its period, about its time, and that's why they're collectible.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
they have that wonderful resonance of when they were made.
Yeah.
Now, you wear them very much making a style statement.
Well, do you know what? It's not often I wear a watch because...
What
a lot
of?
This is a Gerard Perregaux side view LED watch. So.
That sounds expensive.
Yeah, I mean, you know, a lot of the watches, you know, big watch companies did make the LEDs. And GP was... a company that made them.
What do you pay for them now?
Well, I mean, the high-end ones, I mean, a lot of the P1 or the Tiffany & Co. calculators, they're very difficult to come by, so...
So this was $2,000 when it was new.
Yeah.
What is it now?
Well, if you was to find one in the box with the magnet, it's got a gold... It's gone as high as $17,500.
$17,000?
Dollars, yeah, $17,500.
So it really is the gold dust.
It really is. The Pulsar P1 is.
But how many have you got?
Around about 85 watches.
And more to come?
Well, there's a few key pieces I want. But if they do come up for sale, there's a lot of collectors.
Does this cause domestic stress?
Well, she's got, you know, many pairs of shoes, so she can't complain.
Fair enough. Very good.
This is a bit more expensive.
This is a very important thing to tell the nation. Us men collectors have to fight back.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
The only other thing I'd like to say is I think those are great. And Andrew Greener was a fantastic 70s jeweller.
Mm-hmm.
He had a wonderful shop in Jermyn Street,
with
a very stylish front.
Mm-hmm.
Disappeared, the style went out.
Yes.
So I think in 30 years' time, I don't know that I'd be collecting these watches, but I'd certainly be picking the ones by great designers.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
The Sunday Times magazine, September the 11th, 1977, and the headline is, or the baseline, should I say, The Key is Dead, and here's a fantastic picture of Elvis. Now, the Sunday Times was renowned for its fantastic photographic covers, but something else happened in 1977, of which we all here are all part of, which was the birth of the Antiques Roadshow. So tell me, how many of these things have you got? We've got them all around us.
Well, I started collecting them in 1970, the very beginning.
Right.
So I've got over 1,800 copies.
That's quite incredible.
Yes.
Why did you start? Do you just like hoarding paper? Or?
No, I don't think it was a decision that I just said I will keep them. I just happened to start keeping them. And then I had a reason to keep them, which was that we were due to have our first child at the end of 1970. So I thought, here's something that might reflect the period that she was born into and thereafter.
And sort of a cabinet of curiosities for
That's
her,
right,
really,
yes.
Which I think is absolutely fantastic. This is a particularly grim one. In fact, they do quite a lot on Cambodia,
yes,
don't they?
Yes, they did. All the world's hotspots, they seem to be
All the
there.
World's hotspots. Mm. And here's another one, lovely one with John Lennon, Ticket to Ride, Unseen Pictures of the Beatles when they won the Wild West.
Yep.
A very nostalgic picture there. And this, of course, I think is quite remarkable. Photography in the womb, and this is how it appears on the front of the Sunday Times magazine for September the 16th, 1990. So how much do you think you've spent over the years?
Well, it currently costs about £2 a copy. I suppose if you average it over 37 years, it might be £1. So we're talking about £1,800 or so.
£1,800. Yes. Does your wife resent it?
No, of course not.
And last, but by no means least, the chinful wonder, who we've all come to know and love, who now presents the Antiques Roadshow. And this dates from 1970.
Yes.
This is Michael Aspel 37 years ago. Not a grey hair in sight.
No.
Oh, it says, listen to what Michael Aspel has to say about the world's greatest work of reference. And you get a free disc with it. It's quite incredible. I mean, all these ones here, look, they're so exciting, I actually sit down and read them all over
it's
again.
It's a good read.
It's rather like a dentist waiting room gone mad, isn't it?
That's where I collected them from.
And to think that all these years I've been putting them out for the recyclers. But they are, you're quite right, I can see it. They are a sort of a chronicle of the time we live in. Well, I do know that over the internet, certain numbers, you know, things, an Elvis number would certainly go for £10 or £15.
That's right.
I would imagine a Charles and Di would do the same, wouldn't it? But I think that you've got £5,000 worth, I reckon.
Very good.
These are two really lovely watercolours by Mary Fedden. Are you a fan of hers?
Yes, I am. Really, on both occasions, you know, they more or less jumped off the wall of the gallery and I decided in a matter of minutes that I would buy them.
And did you buy these in the years they were painted, 1999? What's the other one?
No.
1998?
No, no. In each case, I bought them about 2 years. I must be the second owner.
She's a wonderful artist and very much in vogue now, because she was born in 1915.
Yes.
And she's still painting as we're talking now.
Yes, yes.
And lives in London. And I didn't even know she was married to Julian Trevelyan.
Yes, I know she was married to Julian Trevelyan, and she didn't paint very much during that time.
But what is so interesting at the moment, the way the market tastes have changed at the moment, people love these sort of modern images. It's very whimsical, this one on the right.
Yes, it's almost allegorical, I think.
Wonderful. And the one on the left here looks a bit Cornish.
Yes.
Do you know where it was painted?
It was painted, well, it's called Lostwithiel.
Is it?
So I assume it was painted there. It was in a period when she was ill and she'd gone to Cornwall to recuperate after this illness. And I think she painted a little bit, but not very much.
The one on the left-hand side here is a watercolour. And actually, it's got a bit of gouache on there, heightened with gouache. And the one on the right here is watercolour with gouache, mixed media, really.
Mm-hmm.
She's actually an important artist now. And as these artists get older, people are looking at their work, and certainly Mary Fedden and Julian Trevelyan, and they're considered very important British artists.
Yes.
She taught at the Royal College of Art.
Mm-hmm.
She did murals for the Festival of Britain in 1951.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
I didn't know
and,
that.
And, you know, she is considered important today.
Mm.
What did you pay for these?
I think I paid about £1,500 for this one.
Yeah.
And I paid about £3,000 for this one.
Well, what is interesting about what you paid for them then and what's happened now, because, you know, in the 21st century, the tastes have gone very much for the modern and also onto abstract artists, right up to the contemporary with Hearst and people like that. And she has also gained huge popularity in the last few years. The one on the left here is certainly worth, in auction today, £5,000 to £7,000.
Yes.
At least.
Mm.
The one down here on the right, I think, is most unusual for her because, you know, I'm sure you've seen many of her still lives that
oh,
she
Oh, yes,
did.
I have. A lot of, you know, bowls of flowers.
Absolutely.
In windows and these, cats.
Yeah.
And,
and these are out of the ordinary for her, aren't they? They're a different subject matter.
Yes, they are.
So the one on the right here, I think, would make certainly £6,000 to £9,000.
Yes. Well, I'm not thinking of selling them.
Good. I think they're a very good investment. But you didn't buy them because of that.
No, I bought them because I like them.
There are many times on the roadshow where I'm confronted by a collection that stops me in my tracks. This is one of them. This is the crown jewel in the camera world, I think. For me, I have never seen a collection of Nikons like this in one place at one time, and I suspect I'm very unlikely to ever see a collection like this again. You know, where have they all come from? What started you off?
Owning a Praktika 35 years ago.
A Praktika?
Yes.
You see, to me, that's a real workhorse, isn't it? That's the basic of basic cameras.
They were great cameras. I mean, you could knock nails in wood, but having said that, they weren't very good, very reliable, and the picture quality wasn't all it could be. So, and the next step was to buy something halfway decent, which was a Nikon F.
A Nikon F. I'll tell you what, let's look at the history a little bit of Nikon, because the company started as a manufacturer of military lenses and things, didn't it?
Yes, there were something like 25 factories and right. 23,000 people working for Nippon Kogaku, which actually means right. Japanese optical industry.
Right. And in that period, they were producing for mainly gun sights, all kind of optical instruments for military use. But of course, the end of the war came, and the Allies forbid them to produce anything for military purposes.
They were virtually bankrupt at the end of the Second World War, and they were looking for a market, and the market was cameras, and they went with this product.
To me, when I think of Nikon, I think of photojournalism, and we've got the F series.
Well, the F has become a legend. It came out in 1959 and has photographed every major incident around the world. It was there when Kennedy was shot, it was there when man walked on the moon.
So let's pick out an F series here.
Well, there are various ones. This one, for instance, a very early F, very basic.
Photojournalists wanted to use these cameras. They were a good, robust camera. The main people that we know, people like Tim Page, of course, photographers in the Vietnam War, used these kind of cameras and would often say that they were bulletproof.
They were.
I don't know how many Nikon Fs saved people's lives.
Quite a few. I've seen a few pictures of Nikon Fs where they've been hit with a bullet there, and the camera and the lens has stopped the bullet.
Really?
Yes.
So there is a bit of reality in that.
Of course, yes.
It's not just an urban myth.
And also... They were wrapped up in plastic bags after being chased by Viet Cong, and they'd be dumped in water, right. Left there for maybe a week, sealed in a plastic bag, you know, with an elastic band around.
And then picked up later,
so as the photographers would not lose the pictures.
Quite incredible. I am staggered by this collection, absolutely staggered. I could talk to you for days about what is just on this table. I mean, is this the whole collection, or...?
No, it's about 5% of what I've got.
5%? But essentially, if I said there's £150,000 worth on this table, I'd be being conservative, would I?
Very, yeah. You get the half of it, probably.
That's it, then. That's enough for me today.
Well, over recent years, I think the name Troika has almost become one of those household names that reverberates around living rooms across the country. And for those looking, I think there's a few pieces on the table that are instantly recognisable as Troika, but I think the surprise is actually that everything on this table is by Troika. And it is a fantastic collection, but tell me, how does it get put together? Where's the story?
Well, I started about 3 or 4 years ago. I went to an auction house in Cornwall, in Penzance, and I saw a few pieces of the rough texture where they knew them were.
The very typical pieces like this at the back.
Very similar to this. And the first time I'd ever seen it, and I just fell in love with it.
And that was it? Sold?
Sold. And I made a conscious effort then to find out more about it.
The firm, as we know, was established in 1963 in St Ives in Cornwall.
Yes.
Three main investors at the beginning. We've got Benny Sirota, who was himself a potter, first and foremost. Yeah. Got Leslie Ilsley, who I think by his own admission was more of a sculptor. And then of course we've got Jan Thompson, who comes on the back. He was a more short-lived partner there. And as I understand, they each invested £1,000 right at the beginning and bought the Wheel Dream Pottery.
Yep, that's right.
But the name Troika comes from, remind me?
It's got a Russian background, Troika.
Exactly.
And it's to do with a horse-driven carriage of three horses.
Exactly.
And bearing for the three...
For the three men,
yeah.
Absolutely. Now, I notice on the table you've actually got one thing for me that is actually so exciting, which is this, the fruit bowl. Yeah. Now, as far as I'm aware, there are only 5 in existence.
Yes, that's right.
Would you agree?
Yes, there is.
So how on earth and where
it was being sold on an auction site, and I undernarred over it.
Right.
And it was quite a high price to start off with, and I left it. I thought, no, I don't earn a fortune, but so I've got to be very choosy. But it kept nagging at me for about 6 months. So 6 months later, I decided I'll have a go, and I got in contact with a guy, and he still had it. And because he was having work done on his house, he needed the money still.
Fortune landed you at the right time.
Very lucky.
Well, it's a rare acquisition. What did you pay, if you don't mind me asking?
This is embarrassing. I paid £2,700.
£2,700. I'm not surprised in the slightest. I sense, so you've not bought this today to sell it tomorrow?
No.
You bought it today...
As an investment.
As an investment?
Future. Yeah.
Now, another thing on the table which really excites me, just because I love them, I love it all, but I love the love plaques. They are wonderful, and they're rare
fantastic
things.
Design. Yeah.
Tell me, how did you come by this one? Because they don't come up very often.
Well, I was fortunate to actually purchase it off the man himself, Benny Sirota.
Oh, really?
I met him down where he lived in Somerset.
Fantastic.
And spent about an hour with him. And I've got a letter here from him.
Read it out for me. What we got?
Well, it says, "To Nigel and Joy, I hope you'll enjoy this love plaque decorated by me, Benny Sirota, as a present for my mother."
Oh, in his own hand as well. Is just like pure gold. I mean, you couldn't want for a better provenance, absolute cast iron provenance on a piece of Troika from the man himself, and a really rare find. Now, this pottery was made 30 years ago when this program was first launched.
Yeah.
Where are we going to be in 30 years' time?
Exactly.
What's this bowl going to be worth?
Oh.
Yeah. It's only got to go up. When you have something that is one of five, it's only got to go up. I think you've paid the correct price for it. I sense, you know, I mean, I would guess the little bottles at the front, £200 to £300.
Yes. Yeah.
The plaques, anything, well, we'll ignore this one, but probably the plaques here, 1,500, 2,000?
Yes, that's about right, yeah.
1,500, 2,000, okay. Face masks are about £800 to £1,200, depending on their complexity.
Yeah.
I'm getting a Benny Sirota plaque with that absolute cast iron provenance. We've got to be talking maybe £3,000-£3,500. But I think in terms of long term, you have done the absolute correct thing.
Thank you.
You have gone out, you have bought the best. I absolutely congratulate you on what really for me is the most glorious collection. It's a credit to you, and thank you very much for bringing it in to show me today.
Thank you very much. That's very kind of you. Thank you.
This has got an amazingly ancient look about it.
Yeah, that's because it probably is older than the Dead Sea Scrolls, I'd imagine.
Older than the Dead Sea Scrolls. Well, they were around Nort, weren't they? This would be around the Han Dynasty.
That's what I see.
Like the terracotta figures. A very unusual thing. Where did you find it?
Unfortunately, it wasn't in my family. I found it in a flea market in southeast London a few years ago on a Sunday afternoon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did they tell you what it was?
Well, it was really unlikely. It was kind of amongst those of just house clearance things, and the guy didn't really seem very interested in it. And I basically just finished a part-time archaeology course, and my eye was just really intrigued by it.
Right.
And I knew it because it had kind of sandy earth. I presumed it was some type of funeral offering.
Yes, indeed, these were grave goods.
Right.
Almost invariably, they were buried, and having been dug up, you get this incrustation, and you get all this wonderful colour building up here.
Is it cast bronze?
This is cast bronze, and the copper is coming through, and that's because of acid attack by the soil. Mm. The thing that worries me is that this would normally be what we call a B-disc, B-I, which actually has a hole in the middle.
Yeah, I've seen those.
You've seen those, yes.
And were they buried under the elbows and above the head?
They were all over the base.
Yeah.
And nobody, they all have pimples on you. Nobody has any idea what they were meant for.
Most
they were supposed to be discerning sort of the future and stuff.
Because, I read somewhere when I was researching it, the really rich people had like shrouds of jade oblong.
That's right. Now this would have been buried by somebody of
what,
serious.
What kind of level of
serious, highly important official.
Like a priest or priestess.
I can't remember a priest, but a highly important official would have this. Now, how much did you pay for it?
Well, he wanted like £50, and I had no money, and I bartered him down to £30.
Okay. Now I'm going to put you out of your misery.
How old is it?
couple of years.
Oh, no! Are you joking? Are you joking? Are you joking?
I'm not.
Oh, no!
I'm so sorry.
I'm really upset.
But hang on, I haven't finished yet.
Oh, God, my life's over. I thought
no,
it was...
No, it's not. It's not.
Okay.
Listen, we are looking to the future. This class of ware is coming from China. Mm. They are casting it, they're carving it, because they still can afford the skilled craftsmen to do it.
Is it this cast is a from fantastic, an original?
No, I don't think so. It's a fantastic bit of work. This is my prediction for the future. Now, you will not normally hear an expert, as so-called, predicting that a forgery is something to buy.
It's like a stab to the heart.
But
so
if you can find that for 30 quid, go out and buy them. Your children are going to thank you.
Oh, God.
Thank you for being so brave.
I'm so upset about
that. I'm sorry.
You hate me, don't you? No, I love it, though. I'll always keep it.
For 30 quid, that is where I would have bought that.
God, I had always envisioned, I thought it was like 2,400 years old.
Listen, if this was real, it would be worth close on £1 million.
Oh, God. Oh, I love it, though. Thank you for letting me know about it.
It feels like a real party atmosphere today. Here we are in the sunshine, at the seafront. What we really need is a bit of rock and roll. Thank you for bringing it.
My pleasure.
So, Rockola, Chicago Company, 1960s jukebox.
Yes.
Are you a passionate jukebox man?
Jukebox and rock and roll, yes.
I'd never have guessed.
No, I didn't.
So this is one of, what, several jukeboxes you've got, or...?
I've got two, and I've got a third one on its way.
And a whole lot of records, it looks like.
Hundreds. Hundreds and hundreds.
So, that, what, 50 in here?
Yes, 50.
50
yes.
in here. And, I mean, the thing about this, which is a small Rockola, because, you know, sometimes they're much wider, bigger, is that I suppose this fits into a small, more domestic scene rather than a cafe or a club.
Well, this particular model we used to have in the 60s in the coffee bars in Tunbridge Wells, where I used to live. This particular model was in all the coffee bars.
So it takes
so
you...
that's why I got it as nostalgia more than anything.
So it takes you right back?
Right back.
Okay, so it's a piece of nostalgia, but it's a valuable piece of nostalgia. I would have thought today we're talking about £2,000, £2,500. And I think we ought to just let it play out. When what else could it play us out on except...
J9.
Well, I think that's what's known as a successful exercise. We have confirmed that modernism is alive and well and has a great future. I have to admit to a great affinity with this building, the Delaware Pavilion, because we were both dreamed up in the same year. The difference is the building still looks exciting. Many thanks to everyone who helped us with this special edition, and from Bexhill-on-Sea, goodbye.
Well, Michael's back in fine form with the Roadshow next Sunday at 8 here on BBC One. Havoc in the nightclub and Ab staring down the barrel of a gun. Casualty continues next here on BBC One. Then gripping new drama with Billy Piper unravelling the Victorian mystery of the Shadow in the North at 5 to 9.